Some people have noticed for the comments in some of the latest computer file videos that there's a new option for viewing them. Instead of just being 1080p and 720p, you've now got 1080p 50. What on earth is 1080p 50? The number after the P refers to the frame rate. How many different frames per second are there in the video sequence that you see? Now, before, because we shoot in the UK, Sean would have been shooting most of the time at 25 frames per second. So yeah, so my hand is running at 25 frames per second, and as you'll see, it sort of jerks a bit compared to my face, which is speaking at 50 frames per second. But let's back up a second, and actually, what do we mean when we talk about frame rates or frames per second? Well, when things move, when I drop this pen, for example, it's a continuous motion. It starts off here, and it falls through all the positions in space until it hits the table and stops. Now, when we capture that to display it on video or on film, we don't capture all the motion. What we do is we sample it, just like you sample audio, into lots of discrete segments. If you actually look at a piece of film, you can start to see this quite easily. What we've got here is a piece of 16mm film. You can see that actually you've got lots and lots of individual images. And each of those images we refer to as a single frame. And when you projected this film, you'd literally shine a light through that and it'd be projected onto screen, and then a bit later on we'd move it up, show the next one, and so on. And so by doing that fast enough, you get the appearance of motion projected either on your computer screen or at the cinema. I mean, we're used to thinking about an image as being a two-dimensional thing. When we're making that into video, we're also extending that effectively into another dimension, time. And so at the beginning, we have this image at time zero. So this is time along here. And then at some other point, let's put that as 0.5 seconds. Of course, in the real world, you've got X, Y, and Z directions on the computer screen. It's flat, so we forget about the Z and only have X, Y. And of course, we have time as things move about around it. So we've got Y here and X here. And we can talk about these things at being at different positions at different times. So at T zero, this thing here is a bit off the bottom and about halfway across. At T 0.5, it may be at the left-hand edge of the image. So it's changing position. Now, you could describe how that moves. You could say, I want to move this from here to here, and the computer could draw all the movements. Actually, when we shoot something with video or film, we do something different. We break it up into discrete samples, just like when you make digital audio, you take the waveform and break that up into discrete samples. We do the same with video. So we break the video up like this. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 different frames for that half second. And each of those frames just represents the image at that point in time. So at point zero, we've taken a photo and we've got this one, and then at time 0.5 over 12, which would be 0.04, we take another photo, and then at 0.08, we take another photo, and so on. So our frame rate, the number of frames per second, is just literally how many times are we going to divide this block up per second. So in this case, in half a second block, we've got 12 different gaps. So this would be recording at 24 frames per second. And that is the standard frame rate that's used for movies. Interestingly, the reason they went for 24 frames per second is all to do with money. When they introduced sound into the cinemas, they needed to increase the frame rate from what they were using in the past, which is about 16 or 17 for something like some of the early silent movies, to something where they could actually record the audio and get the decent quality of sound. And 24 frames per second was the cheapest frame rate, basically, they could get away with. So they used less film, so it cost less to shoot something, but they still had decent quality sound. Completely arbitrary decision. And actually, if you look at all the frame rates used in TV and video things, they've all been made for similar reasons. So for film, it was reducing the amount of film they had to shoot. For TV, it was down to the frequency of the mains system, but we'll come back to that later.
What's the ideal frame rate then? It must be the best one to use, is there? If this was all down to cost, what's the best frame rate?
Infinity. If you use an infinite frame rate, your samples would all be zero width, therefore you'd capture every single bit of motion. Actually, the best frame rate is a difficult question to ask because it's entirely related to what you're trying to capture. If you think to audio, you need a sample rate, which is twice the maximum frequency you want to catch due to Nyquist and Shannon's laws. So you have around 48 kilohertz, which is what's generally used for audio, because it's well over twice the frequency you can hear, about 20 kilohertz. 24 frames per second was chosen for cinema because it's generally good enough for capturing the motion. It's only when you get things going quite fast and rotating that you actually see it. The classic example, which you sometimes see in films, car wheels and things, or things like that are spinning, you'll suddenly see them start to go the opposite direction. And then as they get a bit faster, they'll start going the right direction again.
This might sound like a silly question from me because I'm the one who's chosen to shoot at 50p, but if 24 is adequate to capture motion, and I've been shooting at 25, which is even more frames per second, why does 50 look so different?
Right, well, actually, so this is the interesting thing, is actually if you were to look at the frames captured at 25p and captured at 50p side by side for the same point of time, for most things they would look almost identical. The problem isn't with the capture, so we can ignore capturing it now because that's pretty much the same whatever frame rate we do. The problem comes to when we try and display it, particularly when you try and display it in a cinema. If you think about a piece of film, so we've got all these individual frames, and the way a classic film projector works is you have a light behind it, but the problem comes when we want to display the next frame, in that we have to move the film up mechanically so that the next frame is in front of the light and projected through the lens onto the screen. Now, you've got mechanical properties here, you have to move it into an exact position, so you've got a sort of claw mechanism which does that, but you can't still be transmitting the light to the screen, otherwise you'd get the blur as the film moved up and it would just look like a blurring mess as it went upwards. You actually have to physically display the whole image. And the way that it does that is there's a spinning disc which covers the frame up, so you get a bit of black between on the screen, and then you get the next one. And so you've got image, then black, then image, then black, then image, then black. Turns out if you do that around 24 frames per second, it looks horrible. It flickers like mad. Your brain can still see the flickering on the screen and you don't see the motion. You start to see it as a set of separate images. So the way they got around this when they built the first film projectors is that rather than displaying each frame once, they displayed each frame twice. So you show frame one, cover it with black, show frame one again, cover it with black, move it up to be frame two, show frame two, cover it with black, show frame two. So you're actually showing 48 frames per second, but you've actually only got 24 discrete frames. You're just showing each of them twice. Now what happens is that the brain sometimes looks at that and thinks, what on earth is going on? And I've got a demonstration over on the computer here. So I'm going to play this back. You will suddenly see that it appears to be two circles, even though on every frame there is only ever one circle on screen. So if I set this playing, you'll see you get the appearance as it moves across as if there's two circles sort of overlaid on top of each other. And so one of the things that gives film its look is that you have these two frames laid on top of each other. So the projectors show the frame twice or even three times on some projectors to get around the flicker problem and because of the mechanical nature of them. Now a television works in a slightly different way. A television, particularly a CRT like the monitors behind me, are a single dot which is flying across the screen from left to right across the screen and moving down. So there's only ever a tiny single dot ever illuminated at a time, but it scans from the top left through to the bottom right in a sort of zigzag pattern every 50th of a second. So it appears to display a whole image. If you slow it down, you can actually see the image being built up on the display. Now, they have the same problem. If they just had the CRT display at 24 frames per second or 25 frames per second, then it would look horrible. You'd see the flicker. So they displayed them at 50 fields per second. And the reason they chose 50 or 60 is to do with the frequency of the mains in the UK and the US and in different countries. In the UK, the mains frequency works at 50 hertz. And by choosing your frame rate that matches that, you remove a possibility of getting interference on screen, and or rather you remove the possibility of the interference being visible on screen. So it was a technical consideration again that made 50 in the UK or 60 in the US a good choice for the frame rates. So they update the image on the screen every 50th of a second. Of course, because it's all electronic and not having to move physical pieces of film, you can now capture each of those things 50 times a second. And so actually we have a higher motion rate. And because we're not showing everything twice, if we come back to the demonstration, what I've got is two videos now. This one is the same one we had before. This time it's at 30 frames per second rather than 24. And this one is at 60 frames per second. And what we see if we run both of these is that this one strobes still, although it's slightly less because it's at 30 frames. We get double imaging. But this one is much smoother because we've got the same images sampled a lot of thing, and the brain isn't having to work out, hang on, I'm seeing this image twice, so what's the motion doing? It's only seeing each image once, and so it looks right. This is why film still looks like film when it's shown on the television. The film is shot at 24 frames per second, and each of those frames is shown twice or three times to get the frame rate up to 50 or 60 times per second when it's placed. So you still get that double imaging, which is what gives film its look, not the fact that it's 24 frames a second. It's an artifact of the fact that things are shown twice.
When we go to 50 frames per second, things don't look like film anymore. They look, what, more real?
So, yeah, so I mean, when we get to shooting at 50 frames per second or 60 frames per second or even higher, things stop looking like film and look more real because the motion rendition, as we saw on the demonstration, is more realistic. You're seeing each frame once, and so your brain is able to work out, saying, oh, that's a circle moving from left to right, rather than thinking, hang on, what on earth's going on here with this motion, and so on. It can actually understand the motion because it's similar to what it sees in everyday life. And if you were to increase it to, say, 100, 120, or even up to 300, it would be even more like, and you'd have even more realistic-looking video. The problem comes if you then try and display that image directly on screen. Because things are moving between each of those things, you get these sort of little zigzag effects, because actually this letter T here is moving horizontally, so each time it's captured, the lines are at a different point.